Class of DS-106, my name is Bianca O'Blivion, and I am here with the most disturbing and terrible of news. Last night, I attempted to contact Dr. O'Blivion at our scheduled time. When he did not pick up, nor did his feed come in, I became very concerned. I have gone by his compound, and I have found that he is not there. I can only come to the following conclusion. Dr. O'Blivion is missing. Is it the work of his enemies? Is it his own design? I do not know. But I am enlisting your help. We need to find him. If you see him, if you see him on YouTube, on the internet, the television, wherever, you must let me know. To aid this process, I am asking you, in his stead, to create posters, wanted posters, featuring him, that we will put up so that the search will happen quicker and that he may be found faster. Now, I am working with Dr. O'Blivion's TA, Jim Groom, so that I can continue Dr. O'Blivion's work. Though Dr. O'Blivion is not here to continue this class discussion, I know he would want it to continue, and I believe entirely in his work. Therefore, I will be moderating today's DS-106 class discussion. You may call in with questions via Twitter, etc., as per usual. However, we will be having a discussion with Jim Groom, and he will be calling in now. Let us wait while he sets up his equipment. Now, in the meantime, I would like to talk about Dr. O'Blivion. He is a great man, and I have spent my life attempting to embody and follow his principles. This has meant that I, too, have remained as far from human contact as possible.
It can be anything. Yeah, I mean, there's not always a reason. I mean, some people...
I can only hope that I, while he is gone, will uphold his many great concepts. Jim Groom, are you out there yet? This TA is apparently having technical difficulties. I heard that my father complained several times about his,
Yeah, I mean, she can always contact any of the student technicians or on the phone.
So, Martha, we could talk about this briefly while he's talking. What do you think about this development?
Right.
This whole idea of Dr. O'Blivion's daughter coming on to DS-106 TV and telling us that Dr. Oblivion.
No problem. I'll talk to you later.
I frankly am stunned, Jim. I was not expecting this turn of events at all.
I wasn't expecting this at all, and I'll tell you.
Did he give you any heads up? I mean, did he tell you that there was something going on, that he was concerned about his safety?
Absolutely nothing. Here's the situation. I came in this morning ready to, you know, basically support him as I do, and he didn't show up. I didn't even know he had a daughter who I also couldn't contact with. She contacted me through video. And Bianca, you heard her on the broadcast, right? She sounds extremely kind of, I mean, a little even keeled for someone who just lost her father.
Well,
now, I don't know if that has anything to do that she hasn't seen him in 27 years.
Sure, yeah. That makes bonding hard.
It really does. And it's just strange. She came to me through a Skype call and said, I am going to stand in the stead of my father, who's missing.
Wow. And obviously and you're scrambling, you know, before. To get this together, to make this work for today's broadcast.
It's crazy. I had to put the whole thing together. That's why we were late. And I apologize to those of you out there who are, you know, listening. I wasn't prepared to run class like this today.
I understand. Well, can I ask you, you know, I mean, you're a great TA, but I mean, running DS-106, that's a pretty big endeavor. I mean, if Dr. Oblivion stays missing for the duration, what are you going to do about the class? I mean, who's going to lead that? You know, it's one thing to support the technical aspects of DS-106, but to really, you know, embody the spirit of this class and inspire the students and all of the people who are following along, those are big shoes for you to step into.
Yeah, I mean, he's a thinker. I'm kind of instructional technology. I can do the groundwork, but he's the thinker. I'm a little nervous.
Well, I have taught DS-106. If you need some help, I'm happy to pitch in. No.
Well, I am going to actually call on you.
Okay.
Because if he stays missing, I'm going to need some help.
I understand.
And I'm going to need the community to step it up and the students to step it up. Because what they still need their credit.
Yeah, absolutely.
The open education, the open students still going to want to do what they're going to do, right?
Right, yeah.
I mean, no one class is just one person.
Yeah.
Although Oblivion is big shoes to fit.
Has Bianca looked for him anywhere besides the compound? You know, did she check any of his common haunts? Like, does he ever hang out, like, in Minecraft? Could he be in there? Or, yeah, like,
he
I mean,
might be.
You know?
That's a good question. He might. There's a DS-106 Minecraft server.
Yeah.
It's DS-106. No, it's minecraft.ds106.org.
Yeah.
No, .us. Sorry. Yeah, it's minecraft.ds106.
It's hard, yeah.
And he could be in there.
Could be.
I was hoping he would show up somewhere on YouTube or Flickr, just so we could get some images of him, because it was interesting what Bianca said about this kind of a missing person poster.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a great idea.
You know, and I think, given that he's not here at the moment, that maybe that should be the first visual assignment, since that's what we're talking about, is we ask everyone out in DS-106 community to help us find Dr. Oblivion.
Yeah.
And the first way at it would maybe to create a missing persons poster, and the best three will have some sort of voting system, will actually print out and will publish all around campus.
Create some.
And all around Fredericksburg, because he couldn't have gotten too much further, could have he?
Well, I don't know. I mean, do you know where he is? Like, I mean, you know, where is his compound? He could be anywhere in the world.
He has a compound supposedly out in Spotsylvania.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
But he also has another, he lives.
Yeah, there's a lot of.
He has another underground pad in Fredericksburg.
Okay. Wow, you know a lot more about him than I realized.
That's, that might be hearsay, but that's what I've heard.
Okay. Well, because I was going to say, if it turns out that he has gone further afield than that, the good thing is that with Open DS-106, we have people as far away as what, in Vietnam, Japan, Australia. Maybe we can enlist some of those folks to put up posters as well.
Farm Bill?
Yeah. That might be a good idea.
Yeah. So.
I really do think, you know, I think we... From what I'm understanding on the actual stream, we have some feedback, some audio feedback.
That's unfortunate.
So I'm going to see if I can't stop that right now.
Hold okay, on. Sure, no problem. I'll stand by.
Okay, so. Can you hear me, Martha?
I can.
Okay. But I can't hear you.
Well, that's...
And that's one of the problems, is I can hear... You can hear me, but I can't hear you through this.
I could say anything.
So, that feedback. And it should work. I don't know why the headphones aren't working. So there might be some slight feedback, and we apologize for that. Okay. So, first order of business, Dr. Oblivion's missing. His daughter came in to let us know as much. And what about that hair?
Oh, my God, I know.
Oh, my God.
You can tell she hasn't seen anybody for 27 years. Right? I mean, wow, that's stuck in.
But she spends a lot of time on her hair for someone who hasn't seen anyone for 27 years.
Well, what else are you going to do? I mean, she doesn't go out. She lives on the internet.
That's right.
Stares at her webcam. She's got to look at herself all the time, so.
Yeah. That's up.
Yes.
Anyway, I don't want to get sidetracked.
The
point I was trying to make before I was worried about this kind of feedback is the idea that we still have to go through the visual assignment. So we got the missing persons assignment as the first visual assignment. Hopefully they'll get that up as soon as possible so we can vote on them. And I'll put some details out there. We'll think about that, and then we'll get that out there. And we might have to find some pictures of Dr. Oblivion.
Yes, right, because we don't have a lot for people to use on a poster. They're going to need to have some really good recognizable imagery. Do you think Bianca can help with that? Do you think she might have access to maybe the family Flickr account? You know?
That's a really good question.
That we could.
I'll actually ask Bianca if she has photos in.
Okay.
That would be great.
Yeah.
But
okay.
Now,
yeah.
This is unpredictable news. I'm sorry that we couldn't predict it, but we still have to go on with what's expected of DS-106 for the next 4 or 5 days, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
I mean,
absolutely.
It's too tight.
Yeah. Just going to have to roll with these punches.
We absolutely are going to have.
Yeah.
And so the visual assignments are coming up. And I don't know, you guys, now we have Tim Owens with us here, too.
Hey, Tim.
Yeah.
What do you think about this news before we get started with the visual?
Well, I was on the phone, and I just cut off of that, so I just barely heard, but I guess from what I'm hearing, correct, Dr. Oblivion is missing.
Correct.
That's correct. Wow. You know, I don't know what to think. He seemed a little sketchy to begin with. You know, whether he comes back or not, who knows. I enjoyed his time here already. Nothing against you, Jim. But, you know... Wow. I'm just sort of speechless. I don't know what to think.
Yeah, it's a little bit upsetting. So, in the interim, what do we have for people if we're thinking about visual assignments? And this kind of, we've already started with the daily shoot. Dr. Oblivion got us off with a good start with that. And people are expected to take those daily photos for the next 2 weeks. But now we want to get them thinking about experimenting with different kinds of visual assignments. And Tim, you've submitted a few assignments.
Yeah.
And you've actually a designer yourself, and Martha, you're quite the designer too. So I wanted to ask you guys, given the absence of Dr. Oblivion, I'm sure you had something great to say, what do you think we need to kind of exemplify for some students out there who want to think about what to do for these visual assignments? There's a bunch of them. Should maybe we go to the DS-106 site and take a look?
Sure, I've got a couple of links that I've put together that that I could Skype to you if you can pull those up for people to look at, or we can go through. It would be probably good to show people the assignment interface on the DS-106 site just to start.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Okay, so we're going to go there now. Hold on for the transition, everyone. So we're pulling up the DS-106 site right now, DS-106 site, and hopefully, great, there it is. All right, so here we have the DS-106 site. Let's make one quick distinction before we go on any further. When you go on the main site and you see submit an assignment, you wouldn't submit the assignment you've done of someone else's here. Submitting assignment is only for people who are submitting a brand new assignment. So if you wanted to submit a brand new assignment, you would go in here. It's an assignment you'd think about. You put title, description, the category it's in, whether that be audio, video, design, etc. You put the example URL of a good example, usually the example you've done, if it's your own assignment. Put your name in and you submit it. Now that's only if you're submitting a new assignment. If you want to do an existing assignment within the assignment bank, you would click, you would mouse over submit an assignment, and then you'd go to visual. That's what we're going to focus on right now. So let's go to visual. And Martha, which one were you thinking about?
Why don't we take a look at like four icon challenge maybe? That's a very popular one that people like a lot. I can't remember if that one's in visual or design. You know, the line between those two blurs a little.
Yeah, we should probably talk about that too at some point.
Yeah.
I'll actually want to think about that because it's not always clear what is considered visual and design, and this class doesn't make that distinction so strong. But maybe we should talk about it at least a bit. So here we are on the four icon challenge. Four icon challenge, you submitted this, Tim.
Yeah, and the thing about the four icon challenge, and it's actually something that you'll find with a lot of these assignments that seems very popular, is this idea of taking complex ideas and reducing them down to very simplistic things. So there's other challenges that do the same thing. There's the minimalist travel poster. You can look at those other ones. But this whole idea of taking very popular ideas, things from pop culture, and just sort of reducing it down to very simplistic elements. It's a good exercise to do in general. So this is just one of them. It's taking a movie that you enjoy and trying to find four basic elements of that movie that you saw those little icons, you would say, I know exactly what that is. Bowling ball, White Russian, we're talking Big Lebowski. So
if you want to pull up that iconic aquatic one, Jim, that one was one of my students just did this past May term. Oh,
looks like that account has been suspended.
You know, I have that image on Flickr. I can send you the URL if you want to look at it later.
Great. Let's think of another one. Four icon challenge, Solaris. And as you see, as I'm scrolling down, you see if you're going to be doing these assignments, you have examples of all the people who've done a four-icon challenge. So these are all the people in DS-106 who've done their four-icon challenge already. So let's go to Tim's. We'll do the matrix. We'll look at Tim's matrix and four icons. And there it is. The rabbit, the pill, right? The sunglasses, and the machine guns. Right, and you can make it a guessing game. You can include the title. It's up to you. But this has been fun. Now, Tim, let me ask you, where did you get those icons? How can people go about this? And how is this assignment a visual assignment versus a design assignment, and how can we speak to that?
Okay. Well, let's talk about the icons first. Some people choose to draw their own and scan them in. You can certainly do that. That's going to be for someone who's a lot more has some more artistic background. You still want to try and keep it very minimal in that respect. So, but if you're not, that's not a problem at all. There's two different things that you can do. There's a website I enjoy called The Noun Project, and that's thenounproject.com. If you go there, you can actually get all kinds of icons of very generic things and ideas. So your process should be that you should know what icons you're looking for. When I was thinking of the matrix, I thought, okay, the white rabbit, the rabbit on the woman's shoulder, that was a good idea. So, you know, you have something that you're looking for, and you can actually search or even browse by category on the nounproject.com website and download those images to use. Another thing that you can do is many fonts that you download have things called dingbats. And there are some probably already on your computer. They're usually called like webdings or wingdings. And these are just when you choose that font, any letter you type is an actual map, is an actual icon. So I would encourage people to check that out, and you can download others if you go to defont.com, and I'll throw that in here into the chat as well. Defont.com is actually a good resource for finding any sort of typeface, but especially to be able to find these dingbat fonts and look at, you know, specific things related to that.
Yeah. And that really did. I really love the model that there. You get to see the four icons, and you get to see what everybody's doing, and it's all linked to one visual assignment. And as a student will go by, and they're going to have to do four assignments over the next 4 days, one of which is going to be a missing persons poster for Dr. Oblivion, but the other three are their choice. They can choose any one of these, four icon challenge or whatever is in visual. And if they don't like any of the existing assignments, they can then go and submit their own.
Can you go back to Tim's four icon again?
Sure. Thanks. So to his particular.
Yeah, I want to just talk about it very briefly.
Okay, give me 1 second and I will go back.
Thank you.
And you'll notice how many people did this.
It's a popular one.
So Tim really hit gold when he made this one. I'm back there.
So one of the things that I think is important to talk about when you're doing this assignment in particular, and that Tim does such a great job of with his version, is the consistency of the aesthetic of those icons. I think the most successful versions of the four icon challenge completed assignments are ones where people really tried to choose icons that worked together as a group, as opposed to just kind of random four icons that maybe look like they came from four very different sources. And his use of color in this too is really effective, staying with the white for three of those icons, because there really is no color necessary for those. But the pills, the red and the blue, play such a critical kind of, are such a critical component of the narrative of the Matrix, that highlighting the color just in that single icon just works really well too. So some other things to kind of keep in mind if you choose to do this assignment or something like it.
Yeah, that's a great point, Martha. Awesome. Another thing to consider, let's take a look at it. Anyone have another favorite? I want to actually talk about another, what became a visual assignment. Now, this can kind of talk a little bit about what's visual versus design versus conceptual. A student last semester, whose name, why am I, Colleen Tracy, submitted a really fun assignment called the, where is
it? It's up, I think you just passed it, yeah.
Okay, Flickerize Playlist.
You're looking for stories
Sins.
Written?
That's not it. Where is it?
I thought you, are you looking for stories written in the playlist?
Yeah, where
is it? I saw you go by it. Keep going. Keep going, I think it's on the right. Maybe not.
Stories written in Windows
there it
Media
is, yeah.
Player. That's it. So this stories written in Windows Media Player is a pretty simple assignment. And then when I first saw it, I was like, this is kind of ridiculous. It's basically take a series of songs from your iTunes, Microsoft, whatever you use to list your songs and play them, and actually organize them in such a way that the titles of the songs start to create a poem. And so I thought nothing of this assignment when she submitted it, but soon after she submitted it, a ton of people did this. This was one of the single most popular assignments. And what I like about it is that people obviously got into it, and they tell pretty complicated narratives through these images they took of their list of songs. It also told you a lot about the person through identifying with the songs they like, and they defined through who they were. So that was also awesome. But the other thing that was unique to me is, I was thinking about it, how does the four icon challenge, how do we understand them as visual versus design assignments? You know what
yeah.
I mean? Any ideas, Tim?
I think for me, the distinction in four icon challenge may actually fall better under design. One better distinction for me, I think about it, is one that I submitted under visual. I had this idea, if you scroll down a little bit, the Street View story.
Sure.
This idea that with the design assignments, usually what you're designing is this sort of 2D something. So maybe a poster, or you're working with elements on a screen and just sort of doing something, you know, whether it, you know, it'd be something as simple as creating a poster or a specific image that someone wants you to create. Whereas for me, visual opens it up a whole lot more to where it doesn't necessarily have to be this two-dimensional object on your screen. And so I submitted this one called Street View Story. And the idea was that you could find somewhere in Google Maps and flip over to Street View and find some sort of interesting scene, and that you could narrate that scene with audio and do things like that. So a much visual in the sense that it's, you're not just looking at this image on the screen anymore, that you're taking elements of the real world and bringing them into an actual story.
Yeah, I like that. And that's a good distinction. So with that, do you think that the missing persons poster, which has to be done anyway immediately by students, but do you think that would kind of be more characterized as visual or design?
To me, it would be more design.
Yeah.
More design.
Yeah.
So we're just going to have to go ahead with that. And I like your distinction. It's valuable to me. So thank you.
And I'm looking here, even the animated GIFs. The animated GIFs are this idea that, okay, well, you're sort of designing something, but it's much more interactive and more visual than just something that you're putting on your screen.
And that's right. Animated GIFs is, we'll say it like peanut, like the peanut butter, but that's a visual assignment. So if folks wanted to do another animated GIF, they could. Say it like peanut butter is right here. And this was by far and away the most popular assignment ever on DS-106, but we don't even have a fraction of them because not everybody tagged them. But that was really the assignment that kind of blew up. And it's taking a while to load all the examples. But that still, to me, is such an amazing kind of exercise, the animated GIF. And I'd like to talk to you guys for a second about this, because I don't think I've really talked about it. Why do we see the renaissance of one of the most basic and often maligned kind of visual technologies, the animated GIF? How do we respond? Over the last 6 months, it's exploded.
I think it's a really, I think it's just a trend of where you take a kind of media and you think you take it to its furthest point, which, you know, in 1996 was, let's make an animated GIF of a mailbox opening. And then something happens culturally or technologically where suddenly we're imagining it in a new way. And now you see that media having kind of a resurgence. And what people are doing it with now is so far afield from what originally was happening with animated GIFs. The fact that the technology under it is the same is almost incidental.
Well, and
it's funny because when I was on your site yesterday and I saw there was a comment from Cogdog Blogs, and everybody should be commenting. I hope you know that out there. If you're not commenting, you're not a part of DS-106. That is the secret sauce, ladies and gentlemen. And I say that because I'm the one who has to go through while Dr. Oblivion is missing. So it means something. But I'm on your site now, Martha, and I'm looking at your animated GIF, and it kind of makes me a little sad because
I know.
Dr. Oblivion.
Yeah. My daughter is going to be heartbroken when I tell her this news.
Yeah, your daughter will. And I mean,
I may not tell
Alan
her.
Alan brought it up, and I want to reiterate it, this way in which you kind of blacked out everything else or grayed out everything else and just have one piece that you're focusing that animated GIF in. This is yet another kind of experiment. Timmy Boy, you actually experimented with the animated GIF, and so did Lisa Lane, where you had 7, 8, or 9 animated GIFs telling the story of the movie.
Yeah, and that's actually a separate assignment on there that people can do that too. I think
that's
I did
right.
Wizard of Oz. And
you did.
Yeah, just took really small ones.
Well, and the link, I think it was Tim who shared that link the other day to the tutorial of doing some amazing stuff with animated GIFs that I have to say just kind of blew my mind. Like, we've been playing with animated GIFs for the last, you know, how many months in DS-106, and then I saw that example and I was like, wow, the possibilities here are really endless.
Yeah, well, I want to actually bring up another example that I think was pretty amazing. Was Stella Meme, who's a participant. I really don't know who she is, and I talked about them a bit yesterday. Her animated GIFs that interpreted both the personal cyber infrastructure and the no more digital facelifts, the Gardner Campbell video, just blew my mind. I mean, I think Dr. Oblivion talked about them briefly yesterday, but this idea of the animated GIF now as a hermeneutic tool to think about the concepts and the ideas is just yet another level that I haven't seen too many people explore.
The whole idea in general that you can take these assignments that you're doing or, you know, this visual work that you're creating and apply it back to the concepts that you're learning. You know, it's similar to what we've talked about. I think Dr. Oblivion mentioned yesterday, Julia Forsythe's visual note-taking, and that she actually did that for the videos that she was watching. And I think that, to me, just really opened my mind to this idea that, you know, when you look at these assignments that we do, you know, if you were just to take them at face value, okay, am I doing newspaper blackout story or something, you'd say, what's the point? And then, but it's all a part of this bigger idea of getting you to use these tools to create this narrative, to express yourself and express your understanding of bigger and broader concepts.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and that newspaper blackout is a good example, and I have that on. That was another very popular one. That's a brilliant example.
Yeah, I think it's
one of the things that I already realized, and this kind of happened when I asked students through Dr. Oblivion's behest to play and experiment with their blogs. One of the things they started to do, and one student in particular, Lee Ellis, was experimenting wildly with her Illustrator. She used Illustrator, I guess, to kind of create her own header, and it really was fabulous. And what's interesting is that Cheryl Cohen, who was out there commenting, had some tips for her to kind of follow through on the tutorials that she had created. And Cheryl teaches her own digital storytelling class. She's going to be going over to United Kingdom in probably a week or so and going to be doing one in Europe. So hopefully we can follow alongside that. But, I mean, it's just amazing to me to think that, you know, this visual and design element is something that, like you said, Tim, can kind of fully circle back into this framing and imagining of that identity that Dr. Oblivion talked so eloquently about yesterday.
Yeah, and I think for some people, they're kind of surprised to see these kinds of assignments in DS-106, in digital storytelling, the notion that a single image is something that you would be doing in a class on digital storytelling. But I think that's also a way in which this class sort of challenges our understanding of what narrative is in this space. And for me, the phrase that I always use is that it's about using media to make meaning. And stories are essentially the making of meaning. And so we have students who have done things to complete these assignments that are completely unexpected in some ways, but I think fully fulfill the spirit of what DS-106 is.
Yeah. And I mean, I love this idea of the idea of a story is not necessarily our traditional notion of a developed, you know,
an arc.
Narrative arc.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that we can, but this idea of a visual notion.
Well, in this,
that the, itself is a fragment of a larger story that you're framing through a series of experiments.
And the way in which these stories play with the boundaries between creator and audience, so often the stories themselves are more of a prompt or a provocation than a complete narrative. And so the reader, the viewer, the audience becomes as much a part of the telling of that story in terms of what impact it has on them as the creator themselves.
That's right. That's a really well said, and that's a good point. And one of the things that, when I think about the visual, and one of the assignments that blew me away early on last semester was Tom Woodward's Stranger Portraits. Do you guys remember
mm-hmm.
that? I mean, the Stranger Portraits idea was that you go out there on a regular basis and you take a photo of a complete stranger. And I have Tom's stranger photos up, and, you know, Tom's quite the photographer, but the way in which when you look at this child or at this woman, and you just look at them looking at the camera, and you know it's a sense of a portrait, there's a whole story there to be told. And so much of it is captured in the image. And just his, like, you know, three-line description about the person, their interaction, and what happened, I just found this one of the most compelling narratives of the entire semester last in spring. I mean, it just blew my mind, the idea of simply the interaction between a person and taking a photo of a stranger and visualizing that relationship, which is awkward from the very beginning, is really remarkable.
And using the camera as a way to mediate that entire experience.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And now that's where you're pulling, you know, Dr. Oblivion into the scene again, and, you know, he's missed at a point like this, is,
yeah,
you know, this idea that this is all about mediating the culture within which we find ourselves, whether that be so much of this stuff going back to pop culture, so much of it going back up to the visual world in which we live in, right? And I think, you know, more times than not, we tend to focus on the textual basis, and that's obviously valuable, but the idea of kind of breaking out of the textual notion of narrative opens up a whole bunch of interesting possibilities right. for digital storytelling, because, you know, let's face it, the digital is dominated by video and visual more generally, and design more specifically, so.
Well, and especially with the stranger portraits, to me, it's like the media begs you to, draws you in to ask a question. You know, it's like, okay, it's a picture of a person on face value again. Okay, is that interesting? I don't know, maybe. But you're drawn into it because it's like, what was he thinking when he walked up to this person? What was that interaction like? And so that pulls you in to read the text, to read the story behind it. It's pulling you in to want more meaning from it. So,
yeah, and that's a great point. And the whole idea that, you know, a story, so much of a story, and sometimes some of the greatest stories don't explicitly lay out all those other points. They leave it to your imagination to fill in and wonder, and that's part of the magic of it. And so a lot of these visual stories actually get away from kind of didactic narrative frame, you know? And, you know, they can still be didactic in an image, but, you know, you're right. This leaves a whole, you know, story that happened on the approach to her, the story that happened after he took the photo, what was their relationship like, what was she like, why did she let him take his photo in the first place?
What did she tell people afterwards?
Exactly. Did she go home and say to her family, you know, some weird guy just took a photo of me?
Yeah.
Like, what would that do? And what if her husband got pissed? Right? Like, you know, there's a whole narrative there.
Yeah, definitely.
Trippy. All right. So I really love The Stranger Portrait. Now, Martha, did you just tweet me that there was actually a message?
Well, I wanted, yeah, I was hoping that maybe we could share this. There was, I think somebody had posted, Dr. Oblivion put up a video last night that was really weird and cryptic, and maybe some people saw it. It was on YouTube. It was kind of a spider on a web, and there was a very strange.
I did see that.
Yeah. And
but I couldn't make out what it was saying at all.
Well, and I think it may have happened around the time when this disappearance occurred. So when I was listening to it, the audio was really slowed down, and I thought, well, maybe if I download it and speed it up, that will help to understand what's going on. So I did that. I just sent you the link to the YouTube video I put up, and I've sped it up by about half again as much. And so it's a little bit more, you can hear that there's definitely words being spoken, but I'm still having trouble figuring out what he was saying or whoever it was.
You should probably make that video unprivate.
Oh, that's a great idea.
Just in case. I know that we don't necessarily want the authorities to get this until we really know it's Dr. Oblivion.
I'm
fascinated because that was the one with the spider web.
Yeah.
And there was some weird talk.
Hold on, Justice.
I really want to see what this is all about.
All right, I'm gonna make this unprivate now. I don't know why when I uploaded it, it was made private, but you know that's sort of embarrassing.
No. Look,
just I'm sorry.
Look, we're all a little bit freaked out.
I know it's been that kind of day. Okay, I just changed that. So.
I mean, you know, it hasn't been an easy day.
It really hasn't.
And I really am a little concerned for us. But I think we can do it. I think the community of DS on the
I can't hear it. Do you have it?
I'm gonna pause it for a second. Let me ask you this, Martha.
Yeah.
You did you slow it down or did you speed it
up? I sped it up. The audio was very slowed down.
Listen to it again and let's listen very carefully. Let's get a sense if we can hear what Dr. Oblivion, if this is indeed Dr. Oblivion, is saying, because this could be a clue to his whereabouts.
Yeah, and it happened right around when he apparently disappeared, so.
That's right, according to Bianca, who actually has another report for us.
Oh,
so
great.
We'll be back with her after we watch this video.
Okay.
And Bianca, She'll be on shortly. But first, let's watch this video. Same way, but did we talk about this? What is she saying?
I feel like I hear maybe for life.
There is a for life in there, isn't there?
I don't know.
I thought I heard that.
I don't know. I have to tell you though that in the chat in Justin TV, there's somebody calling themselves Dr. Oblivion.
Who's in the chat?
That's what they're saying. I don't know. It could be an imposter. I don't know.
I haven't been able to see.
You know,
I feel bad for the chat people because I haven't been able to maintain it doing all this because Dr. Oblivion, I feel like I left them out there on their own.
They're doing okay. I've been monitoring it. Yeah, Tim and I have both been in there. I don't know what to tell them about this person who's saying that he or she is Dr. Oblivion, though, because, you know, if it really was him, then why isn't he broadcasting?
Yeah, can they ask Dr. Oblivion why isn't he here today?
They asked him that. He says, I am. Look at your screen. Huh. So...
That's really strange.
I don't know.
That's very cryptic.
It is cryptic. It's odd. It's a little scary. I have to admit.
Yeah. Well, you know, this is part of the problem. This is why we need to get this information out.
These posters are so important. Yeah.
It is important. Okay. So you do think there was a for life in there. And hopefully we can share out that video. And maybe other people can do some work to try and decipher what exactly... It is Dr. Oblivion is saying. Is he screaming for his life? Like, for my life? Is someone threatening his life? Is it the traditional DS-106 call, DS-106 for life?
I don't know, but I have to say that I'm really hoping that he hasn't had any harm befall him, because it would not be good for Mary Washington for word to get out that when adjuncts are hired to teach, that this is the sort of thing that happens.
Especially when supposedly no one has seen him for 27 years, and as soon as he starts teaching here, he's disappeared.
Exactly. I mean, that's bad publicity.
This could be yet another blow up in the Chronicle.
It could. We don't need that kind of publicity.
No, we don't. Yeah. We have to find him, people. If you want your degree to be at all valuable, you have to get that missing persons poster up as soon as possible. We need to find Dr. Oblivion, and as I said, we'll be voting on the three best, and they will be printed and put all around campus. We will plaster Fredericksburg with
And anybody out there who wants to print a copy will be able to print a copy and put it out, you know, wherever.
Yeah.
So
now let's go back to the Dr. Oblivion studio. Well, this is Bianca Oblivion studio, because she seems to actually have a very similar setup to Dr. Oblivion, which is very interesting. She has a few last words for us before we wrap up. Does that make sense?
Sounds great. Well, thanks for having me.
After Bianca goes... we're actually going to have possibly Michael Branson Smith come on and talk to us a little bit about role-playing, hopefully, and role-playing games. So if that's the case and he's available, then we'll do that. If not, we'll probably have to wrap up after Bianca Oblivion. Is there anything else you guys want to mention about the visual assignments?
No, just go make some art.
Go make some art. That's right. Make some damn art.
Make some goddamn art.
Make some art, damn it.
Jim, I was going to say, if you want to point them to the blog post from the design talk that I did last semester, there's a ton of links within that, and I can throw it here in the chat form as well so that they have that. Not that they have to listen to that specific talk, but there's a whole lot of links and just various resources when they're making their posters and doing the things that might help them.
You know what? That would be great, Tim. And when I write this assignment up, for Dr. Oblivion and this actually broadcast, I'll be sure to include all those resources. Okay, thank you both very much.
No problem, thank you.
We're going to go back to Bianca Oblivion. I thank you for picking up the slack on this kind of really you know, late breaking news about Dr. Oblivion's disappearance. And I appreciate both you, Martha, and you, Tim, coming in and filling in some of the time.
No problem.
Thanks again. Okay, and back to the studio where Dr. Oblivion's daughter, Bianca Oblivion, will be talking to us live.
I extend my most heartfelt thanks to Jim Groom, Martha Burtis, and Tim Owens. I hope that you, DS-106, have been paying close attention to this broadcast. You now have your class assignments, and you have the assignment that I have given you. Create the missing persons poster for my father. And while you go about it, keep your eyes on the media. And during your daily consumption of media, you may see him. And if you do, I urge the most to let us know immediately. But I urge the greatest caution, for we do not know the truth behind his disappearance. Indeed, to those who might be plotting against him, I must tell you, you do not know his power, the power of his ideas, nor do you know the strength of DS-106. Again, I thank you, DS-106, and I wish you good luck.
Wow. And that was Bianca Oblivion again. And she really seems strong under the pressure of her father going missing, wouldn't you say? I'm impressed. Bianca, you're a strong woman, wherever you are. We don't know where you are, but we're really impressed with your ability to hold up under such kind of unexpected and dire circumstances. I really hope that we can locate Dr. Oblivion sometime soon. But in the meantime, before we do, I would love to actually see if I can get Michael Smith on the phone. Michael Branson Smith.
Yep. You hear me?
Oh, non-trivial. Are you?
Yes, I am. Do you hear me?
I do. You got some video you can give us?
Let me try. Come on.
There you are.
Oh, good.
Hey, Martha. How you doing?
Pretty good. Made a little.
So let me ask you.
I'm putting.
What do you think about this whole Dr. Oblivion disappearing thing?
I think I've been chatting about it. I think you've got him in your shed.
What? You think I got him in my man shed?
Yeah. And
why do you think that?
And I think he just had a knife to Bianca's back there, forcing her what to say.
Oh my God.
I'm sorry. It just appears that way. You're so devious now. I'm not sure what I think of you anymore.
One could make the argument that I was jealous that he took over my class.
Yes.
And that I did have some motivations. He was not treating me particularly well.
I thought he did well by you.
Well, you didn't really see the bar. He could be difficult, let's just put it that way. I want to be political. He's missing. I mean, I don't want to obviously say anything to put me in potentially harm's way with the police. You're putting me in a very bad position here right now.
Well, you know, someone should go look in the man shed.
Yeah, well, we'll see about that. There is a very big padlock in the man shed, so, and there's a reason for that. It has nothing to do with Dr. Oblivion. You know, we'll see what happens and how this all unfolds with Dr. Oblivion. I mean, we have another 3 days until another broadcast. I think we'll be broadcasting on Monday, unless anyone has anything to broadcast over the weekend. And I don't even know. I mean, this is Dr. Oblivion's TV station, so ultimately he could come in at any time. So we have to look out for that. But, Michael, I've been really watching your blog closely, and, man, you're awesome.
Thanks.
With your animated gifs.
Yeah, I like those a lot.
With your Batman videos.
Yeah, the Batman stuff were good.
That's amazing.
The Thelma and Louise one I liked a lot. That assignment I should put up there
I think we need some new visual assignments. And, you know, you teach. How about sharing with DS-106 a little bit about yourself? You teach up at CUNY.
Yep.
Give us a kind of sense of who you are.
I teach at York College, which is one of the four-year schools at the City University of New York, CUNY, in your. You're a CUNY guy for life still, right?
CUNY for Life. I believe CUNY for Life.
That's right. I love that post. And I teach media production, you know, dabbler. That's why I think ultimately I like this whole digital storytelling thing. And that's why the light bulb went over my head, ding, when I found this space. Because I've been doing, I was, you know, an MFA at the museum school in Boston, and I really just played around with design, with ideas, and then video, and then sound, and so I spent last summer kind of looking through, and then I didn't do that for a very long time, basically. I got a job at CUNY, and I worked in the TV studio managing it and made a lot of basically industrial work. And that was cool because it, you know, I learned a lot about basic nonfiction television and thought maybe, oh, I'd do documentary, but it just wasn't feeling it. And so that's why I'm loving this space and playing around. And even last summer started writing. I have another blog on the Commons that I think I'm going to import into my, the Michael Branson Smith blog, that are all these stories about why I made these various pieces of artwork, you know, over a decade ago.
That's where I first discovered you, was on that CUNY Academic Commons blog.
Right.
A while on DS106 TV, you've done a couple of things. You did that crazy, like, cartoon...
Oh, yeah.
Like, what was that?
Oh, that's Randy.
Can you describe what that is for people? Yeah. That was just an amazing show.
Yeah. That was. I felt like that was my little coming out show to you guys, because I found the course after it had started, so I didn't want to register. And so, but I had been dabbling on the radio a little bit, and then, you know, via Twitter. And, you know, I had this old friend, Randy Borden, who comes in and comes out of, you know, my life. Usually when he's like, hey, can you help me shoot something? I was like, cool, because he's a great guy. And he's been working on this universe called Kaiju. And I'll put a link to it. Which is a bunch of monster wrestlers that is a wrestling troupe, like their live action wrestling troupe. And he literally creates all of these. He's been making these costumes for probably, you know, over a decade. And they're all modeled after Japanese styled kaiju and like Ultraman and Godzilla and stuff like that. And he's created this universe of characters that have plot lines, and they exist in spaces of actual wrestling at locations, but they also exist in comic books they write and all this pieces of graphic design, and it's kind of endless. And so they did the show, and we shot it, and we broadcast it live at DS106 TV, which was so much fun.
Yeah, it was a blast, and my kids loved it. They had these amazingly elaborate, like someone dressed up as like big garbage cans or whatever. Yeah. I don't know what they were, but they were wild.
Yeah, the waffle named French Toast.
So I've been intrigued. I mean, I've been intrigued with your stuff ever since you started blogging on your own site. But the stuff you're writing right now about role-playing games and how that relates to DS106, I'm intrigued by it because, like what you're talking about with this universe of these kind of Japanese-inspired characters, it goes across medium. You have this in-person kind of wrestling match. You have the comic books. You have the videos, etc. Like, what are you making of DS106 as a kind of role-playing game?
What really sparked me was the notion of, like, you know, it was actually even earlier than the Dr. Oblivion, you know, and I'm not going to call him what I think he is, but that's okay. When you called in, you know, DS106 Radio was doing a talk, and then they got on a local community radio station. And you called in as like a cranky, like anti-open ed person. You remember that?
I do remember that. Yes, that was to the Nelson radio station when Grant and Brian Lamb and Todd Gore were being interviewed.
Right.
By the hippies up in Nelson.
Exactly.
Yes, I remember.
And that and the Oblivion, I just, and then you also played this situation with Martha where you sent yourself into Africa because you needed to go on your walkabout or something like that. Not Africa, wherever the jungle was. You were,
I think we were in South America.
Yeah, you were like a Kurtz character of some sort, you know? And so...
The
Antec Survivor. Yeah. The horror. Yeah. Yeah, so you gotta shave your head even more.
What are you talking about?
Anyway, so I just realized that DS-106 just kept existing and with these people playing characters and developing digital identities, which in effect feel like players, like in this DS-106 game, in a sense that your digital identity can serve other purposes, but you're in as like your real identity, you can use it in lots of different ways. And so what I liked, and so I started to research role-playing games on Wikipedia first, of course, and found role-playing game theory, which I'd never heard of before, and is a loose set of ideas that were developed by this one guy, Edwards, was his first name, I can't remember. And it was evolved out of what apparently were basically a whole bunch of flame wars online of people trying to describe what kind of role-playing game was a better role-playing game, you know. And so they define those kinds into, in a sense, this person, where is he? Here he is. Just Ron Edwards started to, and he wasn't the first, but he kind of evolved it into something as like, to settle the storm, said, hey, let's just all be realistic here and say we just have different agendas here. We come to play these games for a different reason. And some of them are, I just want to win, and that's what he would describe as the gamist. And then the other one would be the simulationist, those that wish to just inhabit these, you know, virtual spaces because they're interesting. And I think the classic example that I mentioned is the notion of imagine role-playing all around being, you know, it's like the Civil War buffs. They all show up in their costumes, and they're obsessed with authenticity. And even though they're like, a rifleman, they have to get killed. And even though they may wish their character to become like, you know, some hero, it's not allowed in the simulation. You have to die. And so then finally there was the narrativist. And that was the one that interested me the most because it felt the most like ultimately what I thought would be a great model for education of like where you are all working together to build your fine drama in your identity, and the storyline can constantly change. And so each of them felt like potentially educational spaces too. So the gamist was the person that wants to just get the grade. That's what they felt like to me. You know, we all know students or even been that student. You're like, what do I need to do to pass this course? Just tell me and I'll do it. And I know it's an even playing ground. And so that's what it is. And then the simulationist one really, and there's a lot of value, I think, in that one, in the sense of you want to inhabit this like space of a discipline, and whether it's just a storytelling or I mean, I briefly inhabited chemistry. It was something I studied for a while. And you just know it. You start to know it really well, but you just get lost. And I feel like you just get lost and ignore kind of the outside world or the bigger picture. And that makes a lot of sense. And there's a lot of value in there because there's a lot of content knowledge and stuff like that. But it's the narrativists that felt like the builders to me, the ones that wanted to create pathways and find relationships and build new ideas. And that's how I'm thinking about it right now.
And I would totally agree with you about the whole role-playing game if Dr. Oblivion wasn't real. I mean, this idea of him being in the live chat, his being disappearing. I mean, I think what you're saying about role-playing games in general is brilliant. But what's funny, what happened with DS-106, you know, Summer of Oblivion, seems to have even gone beyond that. I mean, there's someone out there.
He is a character. There's other characters out there that we don't understand either, right?
And they're going to start to emerge, too.
Yeah. You know, they're...
Now, one of the things I think it really works brilliantly with what you're saying, and whether students do get on board or not, you know, every student's motivated differently, and I respect and understand that. And it's not my position because I'm not the professor to decide. I just support everybody. But there was a student yesterday, Alan Liddell. Did you see his video? The March of Time?
Yeah, I did see that. Yeah, it was great.
Oh, my God. Let me see if I could find this. Hold on one second.
Yeah.
I'm going to see if I can bring this on and play it. Because I just think this goes right to your point of a student within DS-106 you know, creating part of the narrative. Right. And it's a kind of like, you know, 30-second, 1-minute review of what happened that day.
Uh-huh.
And obviously, if Dr. Oblivion were here, he could play it on his broadcast. Yeah, and I could just imagine what Alan's, you know, March of Time or March of the News or whatever it is, be tonight. Be something special. So hold on 1 second.
Okay.
A lot has happened. Okay, so let me see if I can find this. I should have had it queued up, but like I said, I really didn't know what was going on. Today really just caught me off guard.
Yeah, it's really tough for you, I'm sure.
It's weird. I really don't know what to do, Michael.
You seem to find
joy,
laugh,
you know, cry.
And I still think you've got him, so I'm not worried about it.
You think I have
him. I'm not worried about you. Well, I'm worried about Dr. Oblivion.
That's one theory now, isn't it?
You're holding him
okay,
hostage. I know it.
Yeah, the news on the march, that's what it is. And here it is. I'm going to play this. This is genius, ladies and gentlemen. This is Alan Liddell's News on the March. And hopefully it will run.
News on the March. Greetings, fellow DS-106ers. Today gives you the third video telebroadcast from your illustrious leader, Dr. Oblivion. In his latest address, he continues to expound his glorious vision of digital learning by illuminating for you humble few who as yet alone are privy to his greatness, the knowledge of Michael Wesch and Gardner Campbell. Dr. Oblivion, in his magnanimity, bestows upon you with a glimpse of his master plan for the world. Gardner Campbell, humble prophet of our glorious leader, tells you how you might become sysadmins of your own personal cyber infrastructures. Cast off the shackles of the learning management system in a can. Smash the blackboard. Free your mind from the oppressive closedness of the walled garden, and you will, indeed, be nearer in spirit, if never in body, to our glorious leader. You will become a better person. Next, Michael Wesch tells you that your identity is that which is reflected back upon you. Lose your environment, lose your identity. Why has our glorious leader left us this vital clue? Is it possible that he wishes us to discover something about his nature? Is Dr. Oblivion man, or, dare we ask, machine? Does he have a body, or is he merely a string of bits traversing the information superhighway? In the upcoming weeks, he will begin to show you your way around the digital. You will learn to communicate in this strange new medium in ways you never thought possible. You will develop an appreciation for Creative Commons and open source. You will forge your destiny and that of billions of others because you are the pioneer. This has been News on the March. I am your humble host, Alan Liddell.
And I don't know what to do with that. I mean, like, I wonder if he knew something was coming down the pike with Dr. Oblivion. The whole idea was he bits. And also, I mean, there's a lot of suspects now.
A lot. Uh-huh.
Anyone could be behind it.
Well, you can come look in Brooklyn for him.
I want to thank you for giving us a frame to understand what the hell's happening, because otherwise I'm lost here, Michael.
I think you can keep playing that game. That's fine.
Well, you know, I couldn't do it without you. Like you said, it's the community.
Yeah, it is the community.
And we'll see how we get by without the head.
But we still need a game master, so, you know, someone's got to take the helm.
I don't know if I'm up to it.
You may have to step up.
I want to go back in the woods like the Ed Texas Bibleist. I'm much more comfortable there. I really hope we find Dr. Oblivion.
I do too. Oh, I've already put my loss poster up, just so you know.
All right, I'm going to have to check that out.
It's already out there.
Michael, you're awesome.
All right, thanks for having me on.
Say goodbye to DS. Let's say DS-106 for life is a goodbye, because this is going to be the end.
Yeah, DS-106 for life.
Six.
All together.
For life.
For life.
For life.